Hey Internet, I'm Chaz.
And I'm Dan. Welcome to Wine is Serious Business, episode 281. We're here starting out a series we're going to call A View From The Cellar, when we have fine folks on that are willing to share excellent wines with us, tell a good story. As you can see, we're sitting here behind the Great Wall of Lorraine. We've got 11 bottles here of Domaine Drouhin Laurene. Our friend David and our friend Heidi, who's sitting just off camera, agreed to share these bottles with us. Shout out to Bill as well.
Bill Jones, yeah.
Yep, for contributing a couple extra bottles. And we're here to taste this entire vertical and talk about them with you. So excited. Can you tell us a little bit about Domaine Drouhin Laurene and what your experience has been with this wine over the years?
Well, the Laurene is basically used to be the flagship wine before the Limited or the Louise came out. This was one of the initial ones. And Veronique, who is the winemaker here, who is a relative of the Drouhins, her daughter, Lorraine, is her older daughter and named this particular wine after the daughter. And it's sort of interesting because they pick it out of their own vineyards and then they put it in barrels, but they keep the vineyards in separate barrels. And then they do a mix and then they do barrel tasting after a while and they pick like the top 15% of the barrels and they put those aside to let them mature a little bit longer. And Lorraine and Louise both come from selective picks of those barrels. And then they just leave them in the barrels while they bottle their standard Normale. And after that, it's they keep them in the bottle for almost 2 years before they release them. So
longer than any other wine.
They've just released the 2012, and here we are on the verge of 2016.
Yeah.
So a few of us have been collecting them over the year, and they just really taste good.
Yeah, I've had great experiences with them in the past, too. You as well?
Same here, yeah. But these tend to age really well, so it'd be interesting to see from young to old.
So what are we going to start out with?
You can start out with them year in. I think it's the 00.
Okay. Any memories of this when it came out or recent tastings of it? Because I don't know if I've ever tasted this wine before.
Well, they had a lot of hype on 98 and 99. 98 was considered the Schwarzenegger year, and 99 was considered the Pierre Bronson year.
Okay.
And so 2000 was sort of a year because there was so much going on. But, you know, Veronique speaks very highly of the 2000.
Oh, he was smart to do he does more research notes before the show's been
Yeah.
So basically, Veronique, who reviewed the wine, say it's a beautiful melange of red and black fruits wrapped up in the texture, and it's one of her personal favorites. She thinks it's even better than the 93 vintage. The interesting part about this is the fact that these are considered ready to drink, the older ones, where the new ones still have 5 to 10 years worth of maturity. Right. We here have found many of the Oregon Pinots can last 20 years without really too much difficulty, much like, and they're blended by Burgundians.
Yes.
And so they will last.
I believe it, yeah.
It's always interesting seeing the press notes for Oregon wines because they really, I think, don't give them the aging potential, like in press, that they often have.
That everybody in this room knows that they have.
Right.
Yeah. Man, the age is just subtly present, I think. There's just a little bit on the darker fruits, a little bit of that age character coming through. A little bit of dark earth.
Yes, so there's the earthiness that sort of aroma that you get out of Dundee definitely comes through on the nose a little bit. Some sort of like, almost like dried mushroom or dried sort of...
We opened these about 15 minutes ago. They weren't decanted or anything, so they're going to change a little bit over time, obviously.
Right.
And the recommendation typically is to let them decant for 15 to 30 minutes, but we're not doing that for the sake of the show. But it's always sort of interesting, as you mentioned, Dan or Chaz, one of you mentioned that you sort of like the initial perception of the wine as you just open it, and then it sort of changes, it morphs a little bit, and then it comes back into another life.
Totally.
In about 15, 30 minutes.
And sometimes we get lucky and capture that on the show, and the hope was that might happen.
Yeah.
So
that will happen later.
Yeah. Absolutely, yeah.
Maybe we'll bounce around.
So yeah. cherry fruit. There's like a little bit maybe like cranberry in the nose, but yeah, earth and mushroom.
Very pleasant. A little floral element there too.
Yeah. It's actually a bigger wine than I would expect. I thought it would be a little bit softer, but it's actually maturing quite well and seems to be drinking really nice right now.
Still rather exuberant.
Yes, definitely. Yeah. Fruit really jumps out on the palate. I think, still firm acidity and firm tannins too. Yeah. Not, I wouldn't really call it a tannic wine. It's not heavy or harsh, but it's... You know, it's not like soft with age or weak in any.
No, it's got really fine tannins, and the color is just perfect. Oh, yeah. I mean, that's beautiful. Not. Agreed. There's no brownness at all.
Yeah, this is a wine like something like this could easily age another 10 years. Mm-hmm. I'm guessing, and I want to say we've had some experiences with this wine that were 15, 18 years out, and they were doing just fine. So, or wines very similar. So.
Yeah. Yeah, I want to say I definitely had some 95s. Yeah, in the that wasn't quite 20 years old that were just magnificent.
Absolutely.
Yeah, just tart strawberries, kind of some full cherries.
Yeah.
Just like this little suggestion of jammy quality to it, in flavor, not in texture. It's not thick at all.
Mm-mm.
Agreed. But real solid. So moving on.
Are we going to score these wines or no? We're just going to fire through or... We don't have to.
I don't know. It's not, okay,
that's
yeah.
That's the O2.
Oh.
Oh, because we took the other one. We took one number one off the table.
Crud.
But well, drink that
you
down.
Know, when you get 10, 11 bottles of wine on the table, you do get lost.
All right, do you want to score these or not? In other words,
yeah, so something like that would be like an 87 or 80 point wine to me. I think it's still coming together, and I think this is one like after we... taste it later, we're probably gonna really enjoy it a lot more.
Yeah, I'm with you on that. I feel like as it's been open a little bit, it'll
That vintage was rated
a little bit. Yeah,
that vintage was rated a 90. Okay. By Wine Spectator. The vintage, not necessarily these wines.
So, another question: why do you? What initially drew you to start collecting Domaine Drouhin?
I think back when. You know, when I started getting into wine and some finer wines, I was introduced to, my wife and I were both introduced to Domaine Drouhin when they came up here through some mutual friends and some wine shop owners, and got to meet Veronique, and just started collecting I love their Normales for just everyday drinking and stuff like that, and they age quite well too. But these Lorraines seem to be in a price range because they're you know, this bottle costs $60.
Mm-hmm. Right.
This bottle costs $60. Wow. I mean, they are very uniform in pricing throughout the day. Some, you know, a little bit more or less, you know, but they've really maintained their price. And then the Louise came out, which is even more, and that's more in the $85 category. So I thought this was a really good, nice, you know, a really good wine for a good occasion.
And I guess that's nice when they release that higher end, that helps maintain the price level of the wines below it, right? They don't need to keep raising the prices on the lower wines if they've got the higher end to make those margins on it.
Like pharmaceuticals.
Right.
Some people do use this for medicine.
Or computer chips.
I think it's 5,000% up.
Right.
Yeah, oh my gosh. The nose on this one is definitive. It's got way more like the cherry cola aspect to it. Like I don't often get cola, you know, in Pinot Noir, but this is sort of there on the nose for me.
It's way more earthy to me too. I'm getting more brown and black earth scents from it. Just the fruit's a little more underneath it. Again, a little bit of strawberries, but earthy character.
Yeah, like briar, as they'd say, or something. I don't know.
Sure.
It is it's a little bit softer of a wine. Veronique says it sort of jumps out of the glass, and that's one of the things that she likes. You notice the last one had a little bit more fine tannins. This one tends to be just sort of a burst of flavor.
Whoa, it really
comes
is.
Out.
Yeah.
And that's what she really liked. But, you know, the vintage was actually fairly good, and they didn't over yield their properties. They dropped a lot of fruit as opposed to some people that year because it was a very big bumper crop.
Yeah, it starts out pretty soft on the palate. There's still a really good core of acidity in the middle, I think, and then just like you said, there's that real burst of fruit flavor.
Agreed.
Right on the mid palate that kind of draws you in, a little bit of hibiscus flavor, strawberries,
cranberry, The tannins are a little stronger, a little firmer on this wine.
Right.
As is the acid, but that helps like extend the finish and kind of lengthens the wine.
I like your idea of cranberry. It's sort of like a cranberry finish.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. Ending sort of tart or a little like mildly sour. But yeah, nice wine. Another one where I'm like, man, you could just bury this for another 10 years and probably
it's
be
still
happy.
Got so much life left in it. Yeah, that's really great.
So this one I like the intensity a little bit more. I like the length. I'd say like 89, 90 points for me. Mm-hmm. It's good.
Yeah, 89 for me. Good complexion as I think about the fruit when I'm tasting it. There's a little bit of evolution there too, which draws me in. It's engaging.
Let's fire through.
Yeah, let's keep going.
Next wine. So this is the 2002.
And this was one of my favorite years for a long time. When I started drinking wine, it was around 2005, and 2002s were still on the market. Really fell in love with some of them, and liked them for a long time running. Mm-hmm. Maybe until around 2010, the fives kind of came up in my mind, and now I'm really loving tens and have had some 02s that have been hot. So it was a bigger, riper year, and over time, I think like many places, some of them didn't quite hold up. Other ones have. I'm really, really curious to see how this one's doing.
Notes here say that this was an extraordinary vintage, essentially.
Yeah.
So I've read that before in the past, that 2002 was considered a good vintage for Oregon. Would you agree?
Yeah.
Across the board?
Yeah, it was pretty good.
This was before I was really consuming a lot of
wine.
That
was before you were born, right? You were still in third grade?
No.
Us old farts can say that.
A little darker fruit than the previous two, I think, showing up in those. I think more towards the cherries, maybe a little bit of plum.
Yeah, Veronique thought that this one, this particular year, because even people that have a lot of experience with Pinot Noir in France that come over, because they bring some of their master blenders from Burgundy over to blend these things. Mm-hmm. And it was the first year, because they've been making wine since like 93 over here, 94, somewhere around in that early 90s. And she felt that this year, the Burgundy mixers and herself finally got the grasp of Oregon grapes. Pinot Noir.
That's really cool.
And really could tune in now. Mm-hmm. And, she calls that Grasse in Burgundy. It's basically where you finally get it and it's just perfect.
I've never heard that before. That's cool. That's cool. Definitely a feeling of strength on the nose.
Mm-hmm. There's a little more, it's almost like a little more intensity in the nose. It's definitely more fruity, whereas the last two wines I could almost sense like the earth components were a little stronger. It smells nice.
Yeah, I sense a lot of, there's a lot of the middle. Mm-hmm. You know, sometimes you get wines that are, nice and fruity up front and they're tannic in the back, but the middle sort of lacks a little bit. This one is completely well-rounded.
Agreed. And this is pretty dang well balanced too. Like it's pretty intense across the board, but there's no gaps in it whatsoever, right?
Yeah.
The fruit is there.
Let's put the cork back in that and save that for
Yeah, this wine is drinking wonderfully now, but I think would continue to drink well for a very long time. This is really nice.
Lots of dark fruits, I think like a mild grapefruit acidity, which I've experienced in other wines from them. Mm-hmm. That kind of like sinks into the gums, keeps things feeling fresh. And like you said, the balance is really there, and it really just kind of lingers slowly on the palate. This is really enjoyable.
Agreed.
Yeah.
Of the three so far, this is just killing it. This is a really good bottle of wine.
Ready to rock. 92 for me.
Yeah, I say 92 or 93 points.
There we go.
That's a wonderful bottle of wine, in my opinion. That's really, really nice. All right, so moving right along to a hot year, the 2003.
Now, you remember what happened in 2003 in France? A whole bunch of people died.
Oh,
really? A whole bunch of older people died where their relatives didn't go and check on them.
Oh, heat wave there.
And French wine, especially, Burgundy, Toby knows this really well, is that 2003 is not a great year from that point of view because all the wines are very over-extracted and sort of jammy. I mean, even the Rhones are very jammy in France.
Right.
We didn't have that bad of a year, comparatively, to the French. And so this was actually one year that the French people really loved to come over here and blend this because it really tasted pretty damn good. And I think this is one of the ones that they keep quite a bit back over in France. just to compare.
That makes sense. Their Louise was the best 03 that I had, so coming off of learning about wine in 02, 03 was a struggle for me.
Really?
There was a lot of disappointment, and it just had a hard time, like higher alcohols, a little green in some cases, because I think it got ripe really fast.
Right.
So it's been interesting to check in on a few of them over time.
I can't remember the last time I had an 03. Yeah, this definitely smells more like jam, like more like preserves or something.
A little bit
right?
more ripe. A little bit more ripe. It's got a little heavier dark fruit flavor.
Agreed.
Sort of in the mid palate to the end. You don't taste the tannins quite as big, and I think that's just because the fruit flavors are big.
It smells like jam to me. I mean, it's definitely more jammy than the other two. Like the 02 specifically was like more fruit, like fresher fruit. This is darker. More preserved, almost reminds me sort of like Fig Newtons, but we're not going there. We're not like in Rhone territory or something, right?
So, sure.
But definitely it smells like a warmer vintage wine.
Yeah, the 03, by a lot of the vintage things in Wine Spectator, are basically past peak.
Sure.
For Oregon Pinot Noir. I don't think this is past peak.
Not at all.
But
no.
I think it just depends on the wine. And I think it's great.
Yeah, surprising flavors here. I mean, like the palate is more sort of like tart and like young cherries. The finish does get sort of muddled up in like the high alcohol sort of thing. Like you can sense it's there.
Yep.
The tannins are present. The acid is there. But yeah, it's all a little would you say disjointed almost, right? Like it's not. It's a tough to come up right behind the O2. So.
That's definitely true.
Yeah.
And I think the fruit in some ways is a little bright in the O2, but it's also more vivacious and more like spreading throughout the palate early. And it definitely dries out in a little more firmly towards the finish.
Agreed.
Back to 88 for me, kind of in line with some previous ones. And also still not tasting all that old either.
That's 87 points for me. That's a nice wine.
All right.
So this is the 2004. 04, I just went to a big tasting of 04. Well, that was a few years ago now. Sorry, I poured you really big.
That is big.
I'm sorry. You can pour some off.
To you?
Find a good home for it.
All right. It'll go somewhere.
Yeah.
Useful. So, yeah, 04 was right when I started getting interested in wine, or I was drinking 04s, 05s. So, really kind of liked the vintage, although I went to a huge horizontal, and I kind of actually didn't like the vintage after the horizontal.
Hmm.
A lot of the wines were the same, so very
sure.
similar. Yeah. Anyway,
I've had some that I really enjoyed, but not a whole lot of O4s have jumped out. Wow,
this smells wonderful.
Yes, it's got that great combination of like full fruit, but that's not too heavy. A little bit of floral elements, a little bit of those earthy notes, a little bit of funky forest floor like the Dundee Hills can really bring into a glass.
Right. Agreed.
All mixed together.
Very bright.
Yeah.
I really like it. This would be that really great food wine. And we're probably going to see that as we get to the newer vintages, we're going to see things sort of brighten up a little bit and not be so subtle. So
Maybe
this is the first year.
Decent balance here, too. I mean, like the acid plays really well with the fruit. The fruit flavors are really like nice. There's sort of the strawberry, ripe cherry. Mm. There's none of like the tart edginess or like any sort of bitterness or sourness leading to the finish. The finish is rather long, surprisingly, like and not like acid carrying it. It's all just fruit that's left on the tongue, which is pretty nice.
Yeah, while remaining delicate, I think, through the entire experience.
This is an impressive 04. Makes me feel better about the vintage, actually. This is really quite nice.
Yeah, it really is. And, you know, and Veronique pointed out, it's got there's a certain, not in a bad way, a little cola.
A little bit of taste
you get out of it too, and maybe that's just because cola is designed to have a little brightness to it, and make you a little bit more satisfied as you drink.
Right.
But this was a pretty good year in Oregon.
Yeah.
93 out of 100.
And right. Whose notes are these?
Vintage hype?
No, these are Wine Spectators. These are Veronique's.
Okay.
Gotcha.
Got it.
And I feel like the fruit's got a real. A real richness to it, right? I'm getting
Agreed.
Both high tones and darker tones kind of out of the fruit, and I feel it kind of expand on the palate a little bit, like biting into a really juicy cherry. It's really, really engaging. Really like this wine. Oh, tough to score when they start to get this good.
Like 91 points for me. Mm. I mean, this is a really nice wine. I really quite like it.
92 plus for me. I like it just a little more than the O2, actually. Put them side by side.
Love it. The top of your scale is 95.
people would say that, yeah.
Actually, hey, I think we scored a wine 97 or something on the show.
There have been, yeah.
You know, 100. I don't know if I've ever actually scored a wine 100 points.
It's always amazing to have Robert Parker has 100 points and it always sticks between 80 and 100. It's just.
Agreed.
Everybody's got their different, yeah.
To be honest, I hate using the scale.
Yeah.
But it's what people know.
Oh, this Rex, right? Goliath. It's about an 87.
Right. No, it's terrible. It sucks to stick them into that, you know, like to quantify them in that way. I'd rather just talk about the wines. Thankfully, we get to do that.
But so. It's nice, and that's partly why we have little longer shows like this. We get a chance to talk about it. You get a chance to hear more than just our opinions about it. And there's a little bit of context, more than just a tweet with, like, DD004, 93, yum.
Juicy.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right. All right, so let's move on to 2005. Right when I was drinking wine, and I really like the wines from the 2005 vintage.
Very excited to try this.
Yeah. And these ones, a lot of the 2005 wines I've been having lately are really starting to open up and come alive. So,
yeah. Was that?
A lot of glycerin on the finish of the 04,
yeah.
Which detracts from me a little bit.
Okay, a little too heavy?
A little too much alcohol, a little too much glycerin on to me on the finish.
All right, thanks.
Yeah.
Wow, this is different.
Yeah.
It is.
Big time. This is like smelling like barrel toast or something like that. It's like some smoke.
Definitely darker, yeah, a little smoky.
Yeah, a huge shift of gears here.
Yeah.
Like, this is all, at least from transition, I mean, it's just like a burnt wood and smoke.
A darker fruit. And 05 was a riper year, I think, too. I think that was definitely...
The fruit is there. You gotta sit there and smell it for a while.
So, Veronique says, true to the vintage, the 05 Cuvée Lorraine is a deep, densely knit... almost brooding wine.
There it is.
Complex and complete, the 05 has excellent structure and balance, which is clear that patience will be very well rewarded. In contrast to the 4, which was a little softer and more immediately floral and tipped in red fruit spectrum, the 05 Lorraine is darker and carries a more serious air.
Agreed.
Notes of black fruit and spice are clearly present. The body is rich and finished long, suggesting a minimum aging potential of 10 or more years.
Well, here we are at 10 years, and I bet those are written shortly after release, although it sounds like they were written yesterday. Okay.
Yeah.
Wow. Nice.
I would totally agree with, like, the dark characteristics here. Like, this is a completely darker wine than the last wines. Definitely more smoky. I would agree with the spice characteristic. A little bit of that. Darker and a little more dense on the palate. Doesn't last near as long. But nice tannins, like the structure here is actually kind of in a nice place, so.
This is something I've loved about other 2005s. The acidity kind of pops up in the mid-palate and kind of races through that dark fruit, kind of gives just a little hint of minerality, gives a little bit of that cranberry edge around the dark fruit and keeps it lively, and adds a little bit of intrigue to me, as well as the delicious flavor. It's definitely full on the palate. The tannins are still present, full, edging towards being a little too much, but they're not there yet. They're not quite there yet. And I'm excited. I'd be excited to try this wine as time goes on, too. I don't remember if I have any or not right now. But
that was a year some of our grandkids were born, so I have a little bit of this 05. So it was sort of interesting. It'd be sort of interesting to try it in about 10 more years.
Man, they're almost old enough to drink 21. It with you, too. Yeah.
They got a little ways to go.
Yeah. Cool.
What do you think, Bill?
I think this needs at least 5 more years.
Agreed.
You know, I mean, it has everything that she wants in a wine, that Veronique wants in a wine. This is going to be a wonderful wine. It's good now.
Yeah.
But it'll soften up, and in about 5 years, it'll start to turn over and just become elegant and full. It's a heck of a wine.
Yeah, really excited to try some more.
Beautiful.
Yeah, it's really quite delicious now, actually. I mean, at least for me, once you get past the nose, the palate is wonderful.
Yeah, 91 for me, and with a positive, exciting future in front of it.
Agreed. 89 plus or 90 points for me.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
All right. On to another warm one.
Yeah, 2006.
How did you feel about the 06s when they were released, Chaz?
You know, I loved them.
Yeah.
So I didn't know. All I knew was 2005 and 2004.
Nice.
Backhand. And 2006 was a complete shift of gears, right? Like, these were just juicy and fruity and so easy to drink right off the bat. I bought a lot of them, and I was really depressed because about 3 years later, some of them fell off a cliff, and you learn lessons, just like in life and collecting wine. So it'll be interesting to see how this one fared.
Have you had any 2006s recently from anybody that you felt really good about or been really excited about lately?
I can't remember the particular vintage as far as opening it recently.
Sure.
So, but I know that we around here tend to pull out wines. I know Toby does quite a bit, and Bill is, that, you know, we don't believe in this 5 to 10 year. I mean, I won't even look at the wine if it has less than 5 years, a Pinot Noir. I don't care what it is. 5 years is minimum. 10 years is probably okay, but a lot of times we'll drink 20-year-old wines, and they get a whole different characteristic. So, but I can't remember too much about the 06 as far as specifically. It's too young.
Sure, fair enough.
What?
John Paul Cameron.
Cameron's
06s are phenomenal.
So, yeah, right.
I think we're corked here.
We're definitely corked here.
Oh, is that what it is?
Yeah.
Oh, you're right. That is a little corky.
That's a shame. We tested all a little when we opened them and didn't notice it, but I guess it just needed a little time to poke its head up. At least we caught it before we got too far into it. So.
You picking that up?
Doesn't taste great.
Yeah. Yeah.
Take a quick cut. We'll be right back.
All right.
We are back with more 2006. Our friend Heidi just ran back and pulled one from the cellar, poured some more into our glasses. We're back in action.
Yeah.
So the wine's a little cold, hasn't been open quite as long, but isn't corked. So,
which means we can talk about it. Yeah.
Yeah. And it's smelling great, actually. It's really smelling great.
Yeah.
Actually, the chill on it's sort of nice. It sort of reminds me of sitting on the deck and eating some cheese in the summer.
Yeah.
I like the little bit cooler temperatures on.
I feel like there's a little more spice coming out on the nose here, too. I'm getting like a little nutmeg, a little cinnamon.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of mixed in with that fruit. Oh, yeah, definitely, yeah.
Not so much Dundee
fruit.
Not so much mold and mildew.
Right, no. Right. Oh, yeah.
We have a friend, Carl, who chills all of his Pinot Noirs ahead of time. He always throws them in the fridge 30 minutes ahead of time because he's like, they'll never be cold again once you've got them out on the table and they're drinking them. So it's good to just see them cold and then as they warm up.
Is that Carl in Sherwood or Carl in Beirut?
Carl in Beirut.
All right.
So I thought it was an interesting thing. I don't do it.
Yeah, if it's room temp, I'll bring it down.
Yeah, good. Yeah.
Thank you, Heidi, for doing that.
Yeah.
That was great.
Definitely.
Oh, yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, fruit flavors right on contact. Cherries edging a little bit
bright
towards
cherries.
Towards candy. Yeah,
yeah,
like bright candy cherries.
Yeah.
Real fresh. And then a little bit of that structure coming in on the mid palate.
It's almost like those cherry cough drops without the menthol, right? Like
yeah.
Very, very focused cherry flavor, like almost a little candy.
Not to suggest none of that medicinal stuff's coming in.
Yeah, none of the medicinal parts of it, but it's just like so just cherry.
And Veronique in her notes points out that the finish is very long, and I tend to agree. It's got a little bit of the Dundee spice, and the finish is pretty long on this one.
Mm-hmm. Really full, bright strawberry flavors again, kind of like the hood strawberries even, and you can tell that this is a younger wine, definitely. The structure is more full, sets in on the mid-palate, and stays pretty strong all the way through the back. Both
agreed.
Both tannins and acidity. But I don't mind so much. It's young. It just makes me excited to hold on to this until, 2026 or whatever, right?
Yeah.
So
it's doing pretty well for a 2006. I mean, it's
very good.
I've had a lot of 2006s, like I was saying earlier. Like, you know, I felt really depressed after I ended up with a lot of these wines because they just sort of became peaks and valleys, right? Like they were no mid palate and all acid, or you know, and this wine is not that.
Or they taste 30 years old after three.
that also happened.
Yeah,
it's really unfortunate. So, but this one is holding on really well. Surprised to say, well, I mean, this is a little cold too. I wonder what this would taste like if it was fully warm. Yeah. Honestly, and like 30 minutes of airtime.
I think the structure would probably come out a little bit. Yeah. I think everything would become a little bigger, probably. Right. Huh?
In this circumstance, like totally, like an 88, 89 point wine. It's nice. It's complex. It smells wonderful. Anyway.
90 for me. Just edging in there, I think. I'm like, it gives me a little bit of something to think about. I think it's showing well right now.
Right.
Yeah.
On to what the internet considers the shitty vintage.
Right.
Can bleep that if you want to.
No,
but
that's all right.
So 2007 got a lot of press as being a terrible vintage. Thankfully, the wines were actually quite good, and they rewarded people who held them in the cellar. I think a Portugal
yeah,
was small.
That's
so.
Fine. Yeah, we'll put it to good use.
Yeah. So I've had a lot of good experiences with 2007s lately, so.
Do you have any memories of 2007? Do you go to the release events, or do you pick the wines up later or have them shipped to you or something?
No, I usually just get them locally, you know, because we live here in Oregon.
Sure.
And have enough connections. Heidi got some for us. And basically, no, we just pick them up every year because they're very, you know, they're very trustworthy. I mean,
yeah.
You know, you can't go wrong picking this stuff up.
And I found that I don't like their wines on release all the time. Like I feel like it's kind of hit and miss right away. But I've had some of my best aged Oregon Pinot Noir experiences from their wines, and I don't know if I've had a bad one that's had 10 plus years on it. Like I've really, really enjoyed their aged wines, and it kind of drove me to think like same thing. Like pretty reliable. It's something I need to start collecting so I can have those aged wine experiences and really enjoy them.
Well, just like here, like these notes you said are wine spectators for the vintage.
There we go.
84 points.
Yeah.
84 points.
It goes from 92 in 2006 to 84 in 2007.
Yeah,
and then back to 87.
How did you feel about 2007 when it came out? Were you nervous about the wines from that vintage, or did you feel like they'd come around in time?
I wasn't nervous about the vintage. All right. Because every year is, you know, another year. They move back. The years move by real quick.
Yeah.
What do you think, Bill?
I tend to buy producers rather than years,
yeah.
And so the fellows whose wines I continue to buy year in and year out, I own them.
Right.
The Cameron, the you know, Domaine Drouhin, and the Evesham Woods.
Sure.
And if you, I think the biggest change in Oregon Pinots over the last 20, 25 years and coming to this vintage is that the winemakers have now been working with these grapes for now 10, 15, 20 years.
That's
and
great.
They understand how to handle the off vintages, the good years and the bad years. I think this is a wine where a fine winemaker understands her grapes and was able to craft a good wine because she understands her vineyard and her grapes. Other fellows, may not have that luxury because they're coming new into the business here and they don't have history with the vineyards. I think this is a good example of a tough vintage that a fine winemaker knows her grapes and her vineyards and make fine wine. I think that's the key to this.
Excellent.
Well, a friend of, I know we quoted this on the show a million times, right, but a friend of Veronique's, Isabelle Dutard, who works at DuPont,
right.
Had a great quote for us one time we were doing a show with her and we said something about, what do you think of 2007 getting such bad reviews in the press? And she said, they don't like 2007. They don't know Pinot Noir.
They don't know anything about Pinot Noir.
They don't know anything about Pinot Noir. It's
It shows in the
wines now. I was initially a hater when I first started drinking 2007s. I came from 2006. All I experienced was 05 and 06 at that point. I was like, these are terrible to drink on release. What is wrong with these wines? Like Pinot Noir is not supposed to be like this. Well, I learned.
But even still, and thanks to Wine Spectator putting 84 points on stuff like this.
It's
you
affordable.
You can still find some of this stuff for great prices online.
Yeah, it's the 07 is a, yeah, it was a poor year, but I don't know, it tastes pretty damn good to me.
Yeah, these have come around substantially. Like this is, but many are weak. I don't see anything weak about this wine.
The nose is the most floral of any we've opened so far, I think.
Agreed.
I'm really, really enjoying that. And in kind of a friendly way, like this does have this like delicate sensibility to it, right? You know, right out of the glass, that's really engaging.
Yeah,
definitely more delicate nose. I would totally agree on the floral aspect. Now that you pointed that out, it's like all like flowers and roses. It smells wonderful.
Yeah. Bright cherries, full acidity on the palate. The tannins, I think, are lighter than in the previous one. There's still an element of structure to it. There's still some strength there that makes me look forward to its future. Being a more delicate wine, I would definitely discourage drinking this with, you know, with some big heavy food, or if you're doing it with a bunch of other wines, I'd say, you know, get to this a little earlier, get a chance to appreciate that nuance.
I guess I just don't find this delicate at all.
Oh,
I mean,
all right.
Structurally, I think it's all there, and I think it's got great acid to keep up like this fruit, and the fruit has a nice intensity. Yeah, it's definitely not the least delicate of all the wines we tasted today, in my opinion. All
right.
So, this one I like quite a bit. Like, it's a little more balanced than some of the other wines we've just tasted. I like the fruit, I don't know, this is probably the next.
Yeah, I think the challenge to a lot of people that collect Lorraine or whatever, you know, like Bill and others, it's really more of a thing of, they all are costing you about the same amount of money. And, mm-hmm. and basically, they don't vary much in price. And so, you need to pick the right occasion for the different vintage.
Right.
And I think the 07 is just one of those ones you show up at an informal party, and it's great.
Yeah.
People love it.
And I think it's a good chance to make that impression that people, I run into some people who think that Oregon Pinot Noir, or more commonly American Pinot Noir in general, is too heavy, and this is a great example of one that's got, you know, that light character that's well integrated, even though it is a little younger. I think the integration is kind of there.
Totally.
Right now. Yeah.
I think it's a fine wine.
Can
this,
open some people's
is this
lines.
Where I interject? They must be drinking too much California Pinot.
I think you're right. Yeah, I think you're right.
Napa.
Yeah, I told Toby that, you know, there's a place that we call Adrian Fogg down in California, and they sell a Pinot Noir that's called the Monster.
And, that's fantastic.
And that sums it up.
Yeah.
I mean, it makes your teeth more purple than a Syrah from Washington.
Right,
it's
so
a big-ass Pinot Noir.
This, I'm expecting, will not be light and delicate.
Probably not.
I don't think it will be a Monster either.
This is the 08?
The 2008.
Very high rating.
Also excited to try it. I haven't had this for quite a while. A lot of the eights I got, I've just been sitting on.
Agreed. Just went to that big post IPNC Wine Berserkers tasting for the 2008s. A lot of great wines, but all too young, right? Like, I mean, what do you expect for 2008? Right? I think these wines will probably survive a very long time.
I was there, and I expected more.
Yeah, same here.
I was there.
They were all sort of baseline.
Yeah, exactly,
like,
right.
One thing that I enjoyed the 2004 tasting a little less.
Did you?
However, there were wines that were like you had 90% of them fit into one area, and then like 10% of them were well above,
right.
or like one or two well below. The 2008s were all right in the same wheelhouse.
Yeah,
which was
just
kind
all
of
kind of. Monotone, if that's the right term in wine.
Agreed. You know? I mean, but they were all of very high quality.
Yeah, they were, you know,
yeah.
Well crafted, but some, you know, just I wasn't as dazzled as I thought it was going
as
to be.
I totally agree.
From what we read here.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think from what there was a ton of hype going into it. I think a lot of press loves to be first, right? So you make really dramatic proclamations about the vintage as soon as you possibly can.
Right.
People rushed to it about 08. A lot of people had the fruit they wanted to grow. They were able to get the ripeness they wanted. A lot of people made, you know, just some kind of full structure wines, and I'm kind of waiting to see how they turn out. This one smells great on the glass.
Mm-hmm.
I think a lot of those like earthy, a little bit of meaty aromas coming out of it, a little bit of dark fruits, but it's still pretty engaging. It doesn't smell too heavy to me, I don't think.
Yeah,
a little bit of the oaks coming out.
Veronique thought that this one should have a little decanter, but the thing that strikes me about this is the 07 was rated an 84 as a vintage. 08 was rated at 97.
Yeah.
And this really, I mean, this goes to the winemaker skill. This is really not that much different than the last one.
Absolutely not.
Yeah.
I mean, the last one was good. This one may be a tiny bit better, but, you know, you can still extract a great amount of skill out of that.
Yeah. She's done well with producing a good product, despite with the vintage.
Well, and I think that's
but still showing the vintage.
That's the opportunity of doing a big vertical like this from one producer is the
that's
fact
fantastic.
That you can, the only variable in this, it isn't the vineyard, it's only the weather and the winemaker. That's it.
Yeah.
And, you know, it goes with the skill. As Bill mentioned, they finally get a handle on what kind of fruit, in what kind of season, the ripening aspects and stuff like that. It's amazing how well they can do it.
And it's great to have that big lot of barrels to choose from when you're making a barrel selection too, right?
Oh, yeah.
I think if your vintage variation, if you were picking the bottom 10%, your vintage variation would be a lot greater, right?
Right.
It's pretty closed.
I would agree, yeah, honestly.
It's pretty closed.
I think it's because it's newer.
I don't know. But it's pretty closed. Yeah, right. I think it's hard to find what you're looking for. If you have something you're looking for in Veronique's wines, it's hard to find it.
Yeah, glad we have some tucked away.
Yeah.
I get like a. Oh, go ahead.
I'm just struggling to find fruit in it. I mean, the fruit is there, but it's sort of muddled, and it's like I can sort of pick out the oak over the top of it. At least that's in the nose.
I'm getting a little bit of blackberry fruit that I think has a good sense of purity to it. I think the blackberry fruit lingers in the center of the palate long and pretty well, but the tannins are still full around and underneath it, and there is the subdued sense of the fruit that just makes me want to sit on it some more.
Well, I think that was the entire... We had, 40 wines at the IPNC, at the Berserkers tasting. And right. I think that was the general consensus. They're all kind of muddled. You know?
Yeah.
It was just the general consensus of 98. Or 08.
Of 08, yes. Of 08, yeah.
And with some producers, honestly, I would be worried. Like, is it going to come around? Is it going to come through? I've had such great experiences with these wines aging. I'm not worried about that even a little bit. But I know I do have some of these, and I'm not going to open it anytime soon.
Agreed. I wouldn't. I think I own one bottle of this. I wouldn't open anytime soon.
Yeah. So 88 points for me now, but
yeah, with the definite upside, but yeah,
it's gonna get a little bit tighter here as we move on.
Yeah. So thanks to Heidi and David for sharing these babies with us. It's still nice to get a chance to check in on them.
Oops.
Baby 2009.
Baby killing, as they say.
A little bit.
Lighter color, I think. Yeah, definitely lighter than the 8. So I remember loving this wine on release. I bought a few extras. I gave some away as gifts because I thought people would particularly like them. Heard good replies from the people I gifted them to. Haven't had one for over a year at least, so I'm excited to see how it's doing now.
I think this is the first one I've had.
All right.
9 was a tricky vintage, I think, to collect. Like, I take in the stuff from the producers that I like, right? And they're like a combination of ripeness, but then firm structure and kind of, so you're like, do I hold them and let the structure try to settle a little bit or let that ripeness do whatever it's going to do?
Yeah. Yeah, or do you get burned like 06 again?
The hope is you don't, right? Yeah. But I'm still sitting on a bunch of 09 because who knows what's going to happen. So. It smells pretty good though.
Mm-hmm.
But definitely a darker characteristic of the nose, right? Like there's a little darker fruit, darker cherries.
Yeah, a little
maybe
hibiscus,
a bit of blackberry.
Yeah, blackberry. A little bit of that blackberry bramble, right? A little dried out bramble in there.
Yeah,
drier.
Yeah.
I get a little bit more lighter fruits. This is, you know, because a lot of times they'll characterize dark fruit, red fruit, you know, and you sort of. It's sort of a middle in between, sort of a sharing over type of thing.
Agreed.
But this one, I mean, and Ken Wright's a good example of that. Some of his vineyards he does is all bright cherries and stuff like that, and the other ones are all really dark plums
definitely.
And plums and stuff. But this one, I think maybe because of its youth, is showing a little bit more cherry raspberry to me, light fruit type of stuff. Maybe just because it's not very old.
It's drinking quite nice.
Enjoyable,
actually.
Yeah. Very
enjoyable.
I think the fruit really lifts the rest of the wine over the top of like any sort of heat on the finish. You can definitely sense the heat on the finish. Like there's a little bit of alcohol, but structurally, it's in a nice place. The fruit is really forward and really exuberant and really, I don't know, it's pleasant. It could be a little edgy for some. It's definitely borderline for me. But.
Yeah, the fruit's definitely, I think, jumping out onto my palate. Both. Front and mid palate are really great, and I think the fruit's got a good sense of richness to it too. Good complexity, really engaging. It falls off a little bit on the back end. I'm with you. There's a little bit of that, maybe a touch of heat, maybe a touch of tannins coming up. It doesn't totally blow everything out of the water, but you know, I think I find myself hoping the fruit would run out a little more. and we'll see how that goes over time. But I really, it's still, I think, a pretty enjoyable drink right now.
Agreed.
Of the lineup, you know, one of my, you know, if you're pouring me glasses right today, one of my favorites.
So if you're going to say like 03, 06, 09, the hot vintages, this would be your favorite?
Any day. Okay. And that's, yeah. I think that really ties into the experience that Bill was mentioning, that a lot of producers, I think, really had a better feel for how to work with these hot vintages. And that when 09 came around, they kind of knew what to do with the crop loads, when to pick, how to treat the grapes in the cellar. And I think that's really come through, I think, across a lot of producers. I've enjoyed 09 more than the other two.
Thanks.
Great.
All right, last one in the lineup. So this is the 2010. I think when I looked at Cellar Tracker, like, this was the highest scored wine of all of these 11 wines.
Perhaps the best vintage for Oregon Pinot Noir.
Yeah, and I would never have said that on release, but I... Oh, sorry. Get a little... more. Why not? You know?
Perfect.
All right. There you go.
So, but as I have continued to enjoy and love Oregon Pinot Noir, 2010 is near and dear to my heart. So it's a great vintage, in my opinion, if not the best.
Was this the year of the birds?
I think it was.
This was a tough year for a lot of people as far as yields.
Yeah, exactly right.
Yeah, it was cold and birds.
A lot of press got on the bandwagon right away talking about how crappy this one was going to be, too.
Oh, but it's 94.
But they backed off of it after the fruit started to come in.
Yep.
And boy, I've been loving 2010s. I think since release, even still, I pop them open. I'm so excited to drink them. I find them on shelves or on sale some places now.
Well, the birds only ate the bad grapes.
Right, yeah, it's perfect. So Pre-sort.
Pre-sorting, yeah.
If they could carry them over, de-stem them, and carry them over to the thing, it would have been great.
Great complexity on the nose. Mm-hmm. Four elements, fruit, a little bit of that grapefruit with a little bit of the grapefruit peel in there. For zest.
Definitely younger than some of the early ones we had, which is a good idea that we went from oldest to youngest.
I agree.
Because this would have... Although it would have been fun
to have this open first, so we come back to it an hour later and see how it's doing.
We'll do the whole thing over again.
Yeah.
We'll turn the camera off. We got them all out there.
Yeah.
We'll do the whole thing over again, I'm sure.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, this smells wonderful. So
this is 5 years old now, and they just released it a couple years ago.
Yeah, it's smoking. It's young, but it's really good.
These are Veronique stuff,
and great complexity already too. It's vivacious. There's a lot of energy to it. I think kind of the things you expect from a young wine, right? There's not that maturity and really full integration of things, but there's so much to be excited about here. A lot of the flavors I talked about on the nose are coming through on the palate. The structure's in a great spot to support all that fruit, a little bit of spice, really exciting.
This is a good example. When you go into restaurants and you look down the wine list, I mean, Lorraine's pretty expensive, but if you look down the wine list and there's a lot of younger wines, this is a good example of that, and the fact that it's younger, it can go with food okay,
totally.
But you know, you really do need some age on these wines.
Agreed.
To really complement how it's put together. So,
like the balance and the intensity and the structure is all there. And I think in like 10 years, this is going to be an extraordinary wine.
I would love to hear your guys' experience on that. You've had a longer... So part of my big fears, I'm loving the 2010s so much right now. I'm afraid that they're going to shut down. I'm going to regret not drinking everything within the next 2 years. You feel like this has a great future in front of it?
I think it has a great future in front of it. And you know, to quote a guy, Jacques Lardier, that he talked to me one time. He was there with David Lett. And I remember the conversation specifically because we were at lunch. And he was talking about how these Pinot Noirs, he said, you know, they sort of close up. They open up and they show you something, and then they close up and they wait a couple of years. And then it's like a flower. It reopens again for a few years, and then it can shut down again. And it's all in that, you know, the organic chemistry of it and how it develops over time. And so I think this thing is probably going to shut down for a year or two and then reopen again. That'll be a great wine over time.
Cool.
We caught it at an open moment. This is drinking quite well
beautiful.
Now.
It's
this
beautiful.
Is just
it's
delicious. Yeah. I totally agree. This is up there with my favorite of the lineup. so far.
Kind of reminds me of the 01.
Hmm. I can see that.
Which I liked. I liked the 01 very much. Kind of reminds me of the 01.
It's deja vu all over again.
Yeah.
Shout out to Yogi Berra. Cheers.
There you go.
I guess as we start to wrap up here, I'm really curious of this entire lineup. Which of these wines were you most excited to get into before we tasted any of them?
05 for all me. Right. Just basically because I have a lot of expectations for it, and we have a bit of it, and I just wanted to make sure it was okay. So it was a great opportunity.
All right.
To me, I think the surprise was how wonderful the 07 was.
Agreed.
Just from the press and everything else, and I've had strong bottles and weak bottles and good bottles.
Totally.
This is a wonderful bottle of wine.
Yeah, and also the aspect of tasting the 00 and the 01 and realizing you still got years to go.
No question.
No question about it. Heidi?
I think I'm put on the spot.
Yeah,
I mean, it was just fantastic. Everything tasted well. Even the hot years were way better than I thought they would be. And so it goes to Bill's comment about, you know, picking producers versus picking vintages. So, yeah, it was really cool to do this.
Well, thank you so much to all three of you for making this possible. Thanks to all of you for keeping interest in the show. I hope you enjoy unique content like this. We hope to bring you lots more. And question of the day to you. What would you like to ask the audience? They can respond in comments.
Well, that's right. You ask that question every damn time.
We do.
I just hope Veronique agrees with us.
Yeah. Fantastic. There we go.
Do you think
maybe
Veronique
she'll comment on Facebook.
She will.
That'd be great. Thanks for watching. We'll see you guys next week.
Bye. Cheers.